Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Code Economy, A 40,000-Year History by Philip E. Auerswald. Narrated by L.J. Ganser. Introduction. Technology equals recipes. A quote from Julia Child, My Life in France, 2006. The ingredients for bread were always the same: flour, yeast, water, and salt. But the difficulty was that there were 10,000 ways of combining these simple elements. Every little detail was important, we learned: the freshness of the yeast, the type of flour, the time of rising, the way one kneaded the dough, the amount of heat and moisture in the oven, even the weather. The code economy describes the evolution of human productive activity from simplicity to complexity over the span of more than 40,000 years. I call this evolutionary process the advance of code. Our modern conception of code, programs run on digital computers, is just the latest incarnation. Code is, in fact, much older. How, one might ask, have we humans managed to get where we are today, despite our abundant failings, including wars, famines, and a demonstrably meager capacity for society-wide planning and coordination? We have survived and thrived by developing productive activities that evolve into regular routines and standardized platforms, which is to say, we have survived and thrived by creating and advancing code. How is this process evolutionary? In the economy, raw materials are like diatoms, amoebas, or plankton in the biological food chain, whereas standardized platforms are like complex multicellular organisms. As code advances, higher-level technologies feed on more fundamental technologies, in much the same way more complex organisms feed on simpler organisms in the food chain. Platforms provide essential structures for the code economy. The infrastructure that underlies a city is a standardized platform. Written language is a standardized platform. The internet is a standardized platform. Human civilization has thus advanced through the creation and improvement of code, which is built on layers of platforms that accumulate like the pipes and tunnels that lie below a great city. The microeconomics you learned in college was generally limited to the what of production, what goes in and what comes out. This book is about the how inputs are combined to yield outputs. In other words, it is about how ideas become things. Here's an example. You are baking chocolate chip cookies. You have arrayed before you the required ingredients: 1 cup of butter, 1 cup of white sugar, 1 cup of brown sugar, 2 eggs, 1 teaspoon of baking soda, 2 teaspoons of hot water, 1/2 teaspoon of salt, and importantly, 2 cups of chocolate chips. These items, 30 minutes of your own labor and access to the oven, bowls, and other durable equipment you employ, constitute the inputs into your production process. The work will yield 24 servings of 2 cookies each, which constitute your output. From the perspective of standard microeconomic theory, we have fully described the production of chocolate chip cookies. Capital, labor, and raw material inputs combine to yield an output. However, as is obvious to even the least experienced baker, simply listing ingredients and stating the output does not constitute a complete recipe. Something important is missing: the directions, how you make the cookies. The how goes by many names: recipes, processes, routines, algorithms, and programs, among others. While I will employ each of these names at different points in this book, I use the word code throughout to refer to the how of production. The essential idea is that the what of output cannot exist without the how by which it is produced. In other words, production is not possible without process. These processes evolve according to both their own logic and the path of human decision making. This has always been true. The economy has always been at least as much about the evolution of code as about the choice of inputs and the consumption of output. Code economics is as old as the first recipe and the earliest systematically produced tool, and it is as integral to the unfolding of human history as every king, queen, general, prime minister, and president combined. We cannot understand the dynamics of the economy, its past or its future, without understanding code. The word code derives from the Latin codex, meaning a system of laws. Today, code is used in various distinct contexts: computer code, genetic code, cryptologic code, that is, ciphers such as Morse code, ethical code, building code, and so forth, each of which has a common feature. It contains instructions that require a process in order to reach its intended end. Computer code requires the action of a compiler, energy, and usually inputs in order to become a useful program. Genetic code requires expression through the selective action of enzymes to produce proteins, or RNA, ultimately producing a unique phenotype. Cryptologic code requires decryption in order to be converted into a usable message. Ethical codes, legal codes, and building codes all require processes of interpretation in order to be converted into action. Code can include instructions we follow consciously and purposively, and those we follow unconsciously and intuitively. Code can be understood tacitly, it can be written, or it can be embedded in hardware. Code can be stored, transmitted, received, and modified. Code captures the algorithmic nature of instructions, as well as their evolutionary character. As you read this book, you will see that code, as I intend it, incorporates elements of computer code, genetic code, cryptologic code, and other forms as well. But you will also see that it stands alone as its own concept. The instructions and algorithms that guide production in the economy, for which no adequate word yet exists. To convey the intuitive meaning of the concept, I intend to communicate with the word code, as well as its breadth. I use two specific and carefully selected words interchangeably with code: recipe and technology. My motivation for using recipe is evident from the chocolate chip cookie example I gave above. However, I do not intend the culinary recipe to be only a metaphor for the how of production. The recipe is, rather, the most literal and direct example of code as I use the word. There has been code in production since the first time a human being prepared food. Indeed, if we restrict production to mean the preparation of food for consumption, we can start by imagining every single meal consumed by the roughly 100 billion people who have lived since we human beings cooked our first meal, about 400,000 years ago. Approximately 4 quadrillion prepared meals have been consumed throughout human history. Each of those meals was in fact, not in theory, associated with some method by which the meal was produced, which is to say, the code for producing that meal. For most of the first 400,000 years that humans prepared meals, we were not a numerous species, and the code we used to prepare meals was relatively rudimentary. Therefore, the early volumes of an imaginary global compendium of all recipes dedicated to prehistory would be quite slim. However, in the past 2 millennia, and particularly in the past 200 years, both the size of the human population and the complexity of our culinary preparations have taken off. As a result, the size of the volumes in our global compendium would have grown exponentially. Let's now go beyond the preparation of meals to consider the code involved in every good or service we humans have ever produced, for our own use or for exchange, from the earliest obsidian spear point to the most recent smartphone. When I talk about the evolution of code, I am referring to the contents of the global compendium containing all of those production recipes. They are numerous. This brings me to the second word I use interchangeably with code: technology. If we have technological gizmos in mind, then the leap from recipes to technology seems big. However, the leap seems smaller if we consider the Greek origin of the word technology. The first half derives from techne, which signifies art, craft, or trade. The second half derives from the word logos, which signifies an ordered account or reasoned discourse. Thus, technology literally means an ordered account of art, craft, or trade. In other words, broadly speaking, a recipe. Substantial anthropological research suggests that culinary recipes were the earliest and among the most transformative technologies employed by humans. We have understood for some time that cooking accelerated human evolution by substantially increasing the nutrients absorbed in the stomach and small intestine. However, recent research suggests that human ancestors were using recipes to prepare food to dramatic effect as early as 2 million years ago, even before we learned to control fire and began cooking, which occurred about 400,000 years ago. Simply slicing meats and pounding tubers, such as yams, as was done by our earliest ancestors, turns out to yield digestive advantages that are comparable to those realized by cooking. Cooked or raw, increased nutrient intake enabled us to evolve smaller teeth and chewing muscles, and even a smaller gut than our ancestors or primate cousins. These evolutionary adaptations, in turn, supported the development of humans' larger, energy-hungry brain. The first recipes, code at work, literally made humans what we are today. Fast forward to the present, where much of the latest research seems to suggest that the advance of code is no longer a boon to human well-being, but rather a threat. In the past 2 decades, in particular, a proliferation of published works has warned of the deeply adverse social impact we can expect from the continued advance of code. Futurist Jeremy Rifkin's 1995 book, The End of Work, The Decline of the Global Labor Force, and the Dawn of the Post-Market Era, set forth one position in what might be termed the great man versus machine debate. Rifkin argues that we should be deeply concerned about the prospect of a world without jobs as machines empowered by code continue their advance. We are entering into a new period in history, one in which machines increasingly replace human beings in the process of making and moving goods and providing services, he cautions. A near workerless world is fast approaching. Others who have advanced more nuanced forms of the same basic argument include Eric Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee, Tyler Cowen, and Martin Ford. From an economic standpoint, their argument is straightforward. 1. The power of code is growing at an exponential rate. 2. Code nearly perfectly substitutes for human capabilities. 3. Therefore, the relative power of human capabilities is shrinking at an exponential rate. If Rifkin and others are correct, we should be deeply worried about the impending adverse consequences of the advance of code. In sharp contrast, Ray Kurzweil argues in his 2005 bestseller, The Singularity is Near, When Humans Transcend Biology, that the exponentially increasing power of code, particularly, although not exclusively, digital computing, will trigger an epical discontinuity in the human experience. From an economic standpoint, Kurzweil's argument is comparably direct. 1. The power of code is growing at an exponential rate. 2. Code nearly perfectly complements human capabilities. 3. Therefore, the absolute power of human capabilities is growing at an exponential rate. Like many others, Kurzweil argues that only technology can provide the scale to overcome the challenges with which human society has struggled for generations. However, he goes further, tracing the arc of code-enabled progress into the immediate future to sketch the outlines of what he calls the singularity, which will result from the merger of the vast knowledge embedded in our brains with the vastly greater capacity, speed, and knowledge-sharing ability of our technology, enabling our human-machine civilization to transcend the human brain's limitations of a mere 100 trillion extremely slow connections. When it comes to algorithmically empowered robots taking our jobs, Kurzweil's prescription is simple. If you can't beat them, join them. Maybe even literally, in cyborg fashion. The great man versus machine debate is not new, of course. Over the past four centuries, it has engaged some of the greatest minds in the history of ideas. Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz, David Ricardo, Ada Lovelace, John Maynard Keynes, Norbert Wiener, and Herbert Simon are notable among them. I will offer more about these pioneers of code economics. None of them, with the possible exception of Keynes, household names today, as the book proceeds. However, over the past 100 years at least, the dynamics of the debate have settled into a fairly straightforward rhythm. One side cites historical evidence to demonstrate that technology-enabled disruptions in the past have always ended up boosting both employment and output, so we have little to fear about the future. The other side counters with some variant of, this time it is different, and thus deep concern about the adverse consequences of the advance of code is warranted. As the great man versus machine debate raged in the 1930s, it involved not just Keynes, but other greats of the economics profession, including Joseph Schumpeter, John Hicks, and Paul Douglas. It surged again in the 1950s and 1960s, prompting scores of congressional hearings and the appointment of multiple presidential commissions. And it is raging again today, prompted by a combination of macroeconomic circumstances, concern over the stagnation of wages in particular, which goes back decades, and new scholarship. Each time the debate has recurred, the same intellectual contest has taken place. History proves we'll be fine versus this time is different. So, which is it to be for humanity? Kurzweil's bright singularity or Rifkin's dystopian world without work? Without pretending to be able to predict the future, but extrapolating from trends that go back for centuries, if not millennia, I argue in this book that a third line of argument is possible. One, the power of code is growing at an exponential rate. Two, code only partially substitutes for human capabilities. Three, therefore, the relative power of human capabilities is shrinking at an exponential rate in those categories of work that can be performed by computers, but not in others. In other words, where Kurzweil talks about an impending code-induced singularity, the reality looks much more like one code-induced bifurcation, the division of labor between humans and machines, after another. The answer to the question, is there anything that humans can do better than digital computers, turns out to be fairly simple. Humans are better at being human. The three main ideas of the book are as follows. 1. Creating and improving code is a key part of what we human beings do. It's how we invent the future by building on the past. 2. The evolution of the economy is driven by the advance of code. Understanding this advance is therefore fundamental to economics and to much of human history. 3. When we create and advance code, we don't just invent new toys. We produce new forms of meaning, new experiences, and new ways of making our way in the world. In advancing these three ideas, I am seeking to address an imbalance in the way economics is broadly understood and taught. Economics, as conveyed in undergraduate courses and popular accounts, tends to focus on choice and consumption, to the neglect of code and production. Choice and consumption are, of course, important dimensions of economic experience, but so are code and production. After all, we humans are producers, at least as much as we are consumers. The book is organized as follows. In Part 1, The Advance of Code, I describe the origin of code, beginning with the production of obsidian axes and continuing through the development of writing, the emergence of culinary recipes, and the evolution of cities. I then set up the discussion relating to the great man versus machine debate that appears later in the book by describing how the job, as it is currently understood, is a recent historical creation, one that rests on layers of institutions that have taken millennia to accumulate. I conclude part one by describing the history of digital computing as the latest chapter in the evolution of code, emphasizing the profound impact it has had, and is having, on the structure of institutions, and thus on the definition of jobs. In part two, code economics, I shift to describing the deep, but today largely ignored history of inquiry in the field of economics that is focused on code and production. I convey this history via the three core mechanisms for the advance of code: learning, evolution, and the layering of complexity through the development of platforms. This story begins with economists' first attempts to understand the net impact mechanization had on human society during the Industrial Revolution. As the processes of production and the structure of the economy both became more complex in the early 20th century, social scientists began to study how firms learn and develop. This inquiry developed into the fields of operations research and management science. Still later, economists came to appreciate how the encoding of widely agreed-upon practices into standardized platforms supports the evolution of economic activity from simplicity toward complexity. In part three, The Human Advantage, I explore the relationship between the advance of code and the human experience. This part of the book directly addresses the contention that the continued advance of code will adversely impact human well-being, either overall or by exacerbating social inequality. Referring to a historical record spanning centuries, I argue that the advance of code has consistently tended to humanize work, and in so doing, to generate broadly shared benefits. Of course, that the advance of code will continue to generate broadly shared benefits is hardly assured. There are things we can and must do to ensure that the future impacts of the advance of code are as advantageous as they have been in the past. The good news is that we've been adapting to and benefiting from the advance of code for more than 40,000 years. By understanding the momentum of history, we can use it in our favor. Part 1. The Advance of Code. Chapter 1. Jobs. Divide and Coordinate. A quote from Alexander Hamilton, Report on the Subject of Manufactures, 1791. There is scarcely anything of greater moment in the economy of a nation than the proper division of labor. Life was simpler in the Stone Age. Consider production. By examining the characteristics of archaeological finds, such as stone tools, skeletal remains, and other physical artifacts, anthropologists are able to trace the increasing complexity of the tasks performed by humans over the millennia of our existence. The earliest hominins had about the same short-term memory as a modern-day chimpanzee, which is to say that they could keep track of only two operations at a time. Fortunately for us humans, we got better. From the first use of found objects as tools, roughly 2.5 million years ago, please refer to the opening sequence of 2001, A Space Odyssey, humans progressed to creating tools and then to deliberately improving those tools for specific purposes. Our methods for creating tools gradually became more sophisticated, until we were using the tools we created to produce other tools in a repetitive and predictable manner. These processes for creating stone tools were among humanity's first production algorithms, that is, the earliest code. They appeared almost simultaneously in human communities in most parts of the world around 40,000 BCE. Humans, too, probably began using stones to hammer. Economist James Besson writes in his book, Learning by Doing, The Real Connection Between Innovation, Wages, and Wealth. But by the Neolithic period, they had developed scores of different stone tools, axes, adzes, chisels, arrowheads, burins, and other types, each optimized to solve a specific problem. Moreover, they made these tools using optimized production techniques, stone knapping techniques that archaeology graduate students have a hard time mastering after a semester of trial and error. What really distinguished the early humans from other species was not conceiving technology ideas, but perfecting those ideas to deal with the complex natural environment. By the Neolithic period, humans had developed the ability to keep 7 or 8 operations in mind simultaneously. Believe it or not, that's pretty much as far as we got in terms of individual cognitive capacity. As a rule, humans today can do no better than our Neolithic ancestors. However, whereas individual human cognitive ability seems to have plateaued roughly around 40,000 BCE, the progress of human social development began to accelerate dramatically. Why? We invented society. Rather than continue to evolve our capacity to perform tasks individually, we humans began to develop something that turned out to be even more powerful, our capacity to solve tasks in groups. As biologist E.O. Wilson put it in his recent book, The Social Conquest of Earth, during this critical period of human prehistory, 60,000 to 50,000 years ago, the growth of cultures was slow, then faster, and still faster, and yet again faster, in the manner of chemical and biological autocatalysis. The reason is that the adoption of any one innovation made adoption of certain others possible, which then, if useful, were more likely to spread. Bands and communities of bands with better combinations of cultural innovations became more productive and better equipped for competition and war. Their rivals either copied them or else were displaced and their territories taken. Thus, group selection drove the evolution of culture. Clan groups and, over time, clusters of clan groups used initial advances in code as building blocks that they combined into further advances in code. By about 10,000 BCE, humans had formed the first villages, which anthropologist Sander van der Loo characterizes as aggregate clusters that solved the most frequently encountered of life's challenges. Villages were the precursors of modern-day business firms, in that they were durable associations built around routines. As the influential 19th-century economist Herbert Spencer noted over 150 years ago, the advance of code at the village level through the creation of new technological combinations set into motion the evolution from simplicity to complexity that has resulted in the modern economy. Herbert Spencer and the progression from simplicity to complexity. From the time Charles Darwin's The Origin of Species, 1859, was published, until at least the start of World War I, and possibly beyond, the theory of evolution was the great idea that drove intellectual discourse. The social theorist of greatest fame during that era was not Adam Smith or David Ricardo, but Herbert Spencer, the first code economist. Spencer was a towering intellectual figure, whose fame rose as quickly as it fell. Among his claims to celebrity is having coined the expression survival of the fittest. His project was nothing less than a unified theory of the physical and natural sciences. His thesis, developed in a hugely influential 1857 essay titled Progress, Its Law and Cause, was simple. Whether it be in the development of the earth, in the development of life upon its surface, in the development of society, of government, of manufactures, of commerce, of language, literature, science, art, this same evolution of the simple into the complex through successive differentiations holds throughout. According to Herbert Spencer, what set in motion the process of differentiation that led to the complexity of a modern economy was the uneven distribution of talents within the populations of the earliest villages. Where there grows up a fixed and multiplying community, these differentiations among people become permanent and increase with each generation. A larger population, involving a greater demand for every commodity, intensifies the functional activity of each specialized person or class, and this renders the specialization more definite where it already exists and establishes it where it is nascent. Rather than putting unmanageable pressure on a finite resource base, as the Reverend Thomas Malthus had famously argued, growing populations in prospering villages prompted increased specialization, which in turn prompted a greater capacity to produce. As prehistoric villages developed further, Spencer reasoned, a new phenomenon arose: competition among producers. Competition prompted workers to seek new methods and materials actively. The creation of particularly successful new methods resulted in the advent of new occupations. Competing workers, ever aiming to produce improved articles, occasionally discover better processes or raw materials. In weapons and cutting tools, the substitution of bronze for stone entails upon him who first makes it a great increase of demand, so great an increase that he presently finds all his time occupied in making the bronze for the articles he sells, and is obliged to depute the fashioning of these to others, and eventually the making of bronze, thus gradually differentiated from a pre-existing occupation, becomes an occupation by itself. The creation of one new occupation prompted a sequence of further differentiations in the economy. But now, mark the ramified changes which follow this change. Bronze soon replaces stone, not only in the articles it was first used for, but in many others, in arms, tools, and utensils of various kinds, and so affects the manufacture of these things. Further, it affects the processes which these utensils subserve, and the resulting products modifies buildings, carvings, dress, personal decorations. Yet again, it sets going sundry manufactures, which were before impossible from lack of a material fit for the requisite tools. And all these changes react on the people, increase their manipulative skill, their intelligence, their comfort, refine their habits and tastes. Advancing directly from prehistory to the technological innovations of the mid-19th century, that is, the time of his writing, Spencer went on to detail exhaustively the cascading sequence of economic differentiations induced by the introduction of the railway. With each introduction of a fundamentally new technology and its associated occupations, the outcome, as he saw it, was the same. The social organism has been rendered more heterogeneous in virtue of the many new occupations introduced, and the many old ones further specialized. Prices in every place have been altered. Each trader has more or less modified his way of doing business, and almost every person has been affected in his actions, thoughts, emotions. It was in the village, then, that code began to evolve. Granted, if assessed in terms of the lived experience of most human beings, the evolution of code got off to a slow start. As Thomas Hobbes put it in his 1689 masterwork, Leviathan, life, for most of history until that point, was not only nasty, brutish, and short, but also, and more to the point, men lived on gross experience. There was no method, that is to say, no sowing nor planting of knowledge by itself, apart from the weeds and common plants of error and conjecture. The first recorded use of the word job, in the sense of work done for pay, is reported by the Oxford English Dictionary to have occurred in 1557, a little more than a century before Hobbes wrote Leviathan. In documents relating to the revels at court in the time of King Edward VI and Queen Mary, Albert Fouillerat employs the phrase job of work to signify a piece of work. This usage likely stems from the word gob, which then, as today, signifies a mass or a lump. Etymologically speaking, then, the job was originally a lump. The advent of the job as a lump of work was to the evolution of modern society something like what the first single-celled organism was to the evolution of life, The job contrasted with the obligation to perform labor continuously and without clearly defined roles, slavery, serfdom, indentured servitude, or even apprenticeship, as had been the norm through human history. In the medieval European world, work was an obligation subject to enforcement by feudal lords. Jobs and unemployment, as we understand them today, did not yet exist. As the great Austrian economist Joseph Schumpeter notes in his vast History of Economic Analysis, in principle, medieval society provided a berth for everyone whom it recognized as a member. Its structural design excluded unemployment and destitution. In normal times, unemployment was quantitatively unimportant and confined to individuals who had broken loose from their environment or had been cast off by it, and who in consequence had become beggars, vagrants, and highwaymen. As a result, mass unemployment, definitely unconnected with any personal shortcomings of the unemployed, was unknown to the Middle Ages, except as a consequence of social catastrophes, such as devastation by wars, feuds, and plagues. When, in the aftermath of the bubonic plague, labor suddenly was in short supply, European monarchs responded by placing restrictions on the mobility of workers. The Ordinance of Laborers, issued by King Edward III of England on June 18, 1349, included the following mandate: every man or woman, free or unfree, aged 60 years or younger, and without land or a craft sufficient for self-support, must serve whoever required his labor. Furthermore, the wages of servants, laborers, and artisans must be no higher than had been customary in a given locality in 1346 or common years thereabouts. Parliament subsequently passed the Statute of Laborers, which was intended to address the ongoing malice of servants who were idle and refused to serve after the pestilence. Whereas the ordinance had set only vague limits on wages, the statute went further, specifying specific rates for a range of occupations on the basis of piecework or a day's work. While intended to constrain workers' ability to negotiate higher pay with their baronial employers, these statutes, in effect, affirmed the existence of a labor market. In its way, then, the Black Death helped to institutionalize wage work. While medieval workers were subject to the whims of monarchical authority when it came to the imposition of wage controls, in another sense, they had a great deal more autonomy than most workers today. Although they may have belonged to guilds that set guidelines for the how of production, the medieval baker, blacksmith, and milliner were masters of their own trade. The guilds acted at a distance. So, although medieval artisans may have been circumscribed by tradition and culture, they did not have to conform to any manual or set of standard operating procedures, follow prescribed recipes, or endure having anything like a boss looking over their shoulders at work. The job, as we know it today, is a relatively recent product of the co-evolution of code and work, which in turn began when humans perfected specialization. Plato wrote in The Republic, circa 360 BCE, "All things are produced more plentifully and easily and of a better quality when one man does one thing which is natural to him and does it at the right time and leaves other things. Human workers therefore initially specialized in trades, which were defined at the individual level and naturally evolved into institutions defined around specific social needs, bakeries, smithies, taverns, and the like. Change was so slow in early society relative to the human lifespan that people came to be named for their occupations: baker, barker, cooper, kramer, Eisenhower, which means iron worker, shoemaker, smith, tiler, wagner, Right, and many more. All these occupations became family names that had been passed on through the generations as enduring markers of past societal stasis. These institutions became more complex over the centuries as labor was broken down into more specific tasks. Famously using a pin factory as an example, Adam Smith opens The Wealth of Nations by highlighting the benefits of specialization by task. The greatest improvement in the productive powers of labor, and the greater part of the skill, dexterity, and judgment with which it is anywhere directed or applied, seem to have been the effects of the division of labor. 15 years later, Alexander Hamilton stressed the importance of the division of labor in the Report on Manufacturers, which was a major salvo in his debate with Thomas Jefferson over the relative value of manufacturing versus agriculture to the economic future of the newly founded United States of America. As quoted at the start of this chapter, Hamilton wrote that there is scarcely anything of greater moment in the economy of a nation than the proper division of labor. In the past 200 years, the complexity of human economic organization has increased by orders of magnitude. Death rates began to fall rapidly in the middle of the 19th century due to a combination of increased agricultural output, improved hygiene, and the beginning of better medical practices, all different dimensions of the advance of code. Accordingly, the population grew. As newly invented machines and improved practices, again, read code, reduced the need for manual labor in agriculture, urbanization rapidly intensified, and humanity's cognitive surplus increased. Greater numbers of people living in greater density than ever before accelerated the advance of code. By the 20th century, the continued advance of code necessitated the creation of government bureaucracies and large corporations that employed vast numbers of people. These organizations executed code of sufficient complexity that it was beyond the capacity of any single individual to master. To structure work within such large, complex organizations, humans began to define occupations in terms of specific, task-defined roles rather than by artisanal trades, as had been the case throughout human history. We came to call these task-defined roles jobs. Jobs were very different from the trades, in that they were designed to optimize institutional operations rather than to perpetuate and advance inherited, mostly unwritten production practices. In this way, the artisans, serfs, and merchants who defined the medieval agrarian economy were replaced by an industrial economic order dominated by workers who executed the subroutines of complex algorithms performed by large corporate entities. Thus, the organization man came into existence. Two broad categories of epochal change occurred as a result of the evolution of the economy from simplicity to complexity, which I refer to as the advance of code. One is that our capabilities grew, individually and collectively. For instance, we can now fly. I am encoding these very words while moving far above the clouds at a speed many times faster than the fastest chariot, employing a highly evolved abacus known as a computer, whose history and operation I will describe later in the book. This is an impressive achievement. We can carry on conversations with people anywhere around the world. By consuming small quantities of a serum made from mold, we can defeat microscopic armies that attack our bodies. We can use eggs to make a delicious sauce known as mayonnaise. See Chapter 7. But that's not all. The second epochal change related to the advance of code is that we have, to an increasing degree, ceded to other people, and to code itself, authority and autonomy, which for millennia we had kept unto ourselves and our immediate tribal groups as uncodified cultural norms. We now obey written laws and rules. We follow instructions. We respect elected officials, in our actions, if not always our thoughts. And the elected officials respect electoral processes, in their thoughts, if not always their actions. We do our jobs. We no longer have our own wells or, in most cases, our own gardens. Most of us, myself included, have forgotten how to hunt. We depend for our survival on an ever-growing array of services provided by others who, in turn, are ceding an increasing amount of their authority to code. We are at once increasingly empowered and increasingly disempowered, increasingly vulnerable and increasingly omnipotent, all due to the advance of code. The effects of the advance of code reflect this duality. In the aggregate, the advance of code over the millennia has had some astonishingly positive consequences. Our largest villages sustain far more people today than were alive on the entire planet 40,000 years ago. We call these largest villages cities. Babies born today nearly anywhere in the world can expect to live twice as long as babies born in the same places only 200 years ago. At any time, and in almost any place, we have access to vast libraries of accumulated knowledge and powers of computation many orders of magnitude greater than those possessed by the totality of humanity a century ago, and all are literally accessible in the palms of our hands. The advance of code has also had negative consequences. Perhaps most significant is that we fall well short of fully expressing our humanity through code. When code overrides morality, I was just following orders, terrible consequences can result. Furthermore, the operation of code does not necessarily, or in all places, lead to more equitable outcomes than its predecessor in the organization of human society, brute force. In the code economy, those who author, store, and enforce code, by definition, have more power than those who execute code. Those who execute code, in turn, generally fare better than those who are excluded from code. For this reason, people who have the opportunity and the capacity to keep up with the advance of code have a greater opportunity to create and contribute to society than those who do not. For better and for worse, humanity and code are co-evolving. What we call the economy necessarily encompasses both. While Hobbes may have underestimated the power of oral traditions to store and convey code, it is true that human societies did not develop methods to create and assess code systematically until the Age of Enlightenment in Europe. Long after the advent of villages, human communities remained relatively small and sparsely distributed, which meant there were few people around to try out new ways of doing things and few opportunities to share those new methods. And although writing was invented more than 5,000 years ago, a majority of the world's people have been literate only for the past century. As a consequence, code advanced slowly. For 14,000 years after the first villages formed, the human lifespan barely budged, and the global population grew at a glacial pace. From the first century BCE to the late 18th century, both economic and population growth rates were well below 0.1% per year. Perhaps counterintuitively, these millennia of relative stasis in the human experience produced many of humanity's greatest creations. Writing, decimal numbers, algebra, watermills, the astrolabe, eyeglasses, mechanical clocks, the printing press, multi-masted ships, and bills of exchange, to name but a few. Each of these advances in technology was accompanied by an advance in code, the evolution of which progressively expanded human capabilities. These advances also set the stage for the rapid improvement in the human condition that we have seen over the past two centuries. In the next chapter, I focus on two human creations that arguably have advanced human development more than any others: writing and cities. Chapter 2. Code. This is the procedure. A quote from Alfred North Whitehead, An Introduction to Mathematics, 1911. Civilization advances by extending the number of operations we can perform without thinking about them. Writing and cities are inarguably two of humanity's most powerful creations. Both have helped drive improvements in human well-being over the span of millennia. The innovation that is writing goes well beyond any implement used in the encoding process, be it the chisel, the stylus, the printing press, or the digital computer. Much as the innovation that is the city goes well beyond the buildings and roads that constitute its physical aspects. Writing, which is itself a form of code, enables humans to communicate code. Cities grow as code evolves. Sumerian's medium of choice for storing writing preceded the papyrus scroll used in Egypt and the paper used in Europe. They used tablets made of stone and clay. Since the discovery of Sumerian pictographic and cuneiform writing more than a century ago on the ancient Mesopotamian plain, present-day Iraq, major excavations have unearthed over 250,000 tablets and tablet fragments. Scholarly research has focused largely on the estimated 1% of these tablets that contain literary content. Far less attention has been paid to the overwhelming majority of tablets that relate primarily to economic activities, such as receipts, sales contracts, worker lists, wages, and natural resource and lexical lists. If the ratio of literary to economic tablets found accurately reflects those actually produced, then the tablets as a whole suggest that the Sumerians created not only the world's first organized system of writing, but also the world's first large-scale database technology. The development of writing as a database technology reflects many patterns we find in later technologies. For one thing, it provides evidence of both discontinuous and incremental learning. Between 3200 BCE and 1500 BCE, for example, writing technology improved along every dimension. Markings initially carved in stone and on small rocks known as bulli were later etched on clay tablets. Accordingly, the chisel used to inscribe on stone was replaced by the reed stylus. The clay tablets, which initially were sun-dried, were later baked in kilns to improve their strength. Kiln technology also changed dramatically from primitive baking structures to high-temperature ovens. During the same period, the method of encoding tablets evolved to enable more efficient data entry. From approximately 3000 BCE to 2000 BCE, pictographs gave way to curvilinear symbols known as proto-cuneiform, and then to straight-edged cuneiform symbols. As technology evolved, human work evolved with it. Over time, the labor involved in writing on tablets became differentiated by skill level. Early references to scribes name only the dubsar, one who writes. Later references also refer to an accomplished subset of scribes known as dubsarma, excellent writer, and still later to an elite group known as the dubsarlugal, king of writers. There is evidence that, toward the end of this period, some scribes specialized in literary writing, while the remainder continued to record economic data. Scribal organizations grew from small tablet houses to large proto-universities that by 1700 BCE were producing various forms of literature and treatises that ranged from divination to deductive reasoning, the first forms of science, to legal codes. Perhaps the most profound innovation in Sumerian writing, however, was the cognitive leap that took place from a simple mnemonic, the accounting device pictograms were first used for, into abstract syllabograms, which are phonetic representations of the spoken language. Syllabograms made it possible to produce a more complicated message, and thus to relate a greater amount of information. For example, the etched symbol of a cow changed to a cuneiform symbol representing a cow, which later was transformed into a sound, such as ah-ba, that no longer literally meant cow, but became a phonetic term, that could be combined with another phonetic term through a series of established rules. This breakthrough is one of the more intellectually profound advancements in the Sumerian information system, which was subsequently copied by other Mesopotamian peoples, such as the Akkadians and the Babylonians, and by other cultures throughout time. As a result of these cumulative innovations, the density of information stored on each tablet increased, even as the cost of producing tablets decreased, which is an early example of an organizational learning curve, a phenomenon to which I will return in detail in Chapter 7. Creating tablets was itself a production technology, a particularly powerful one, as it enabled humans to encode other production technologies. One of the earliest known tablets, 3700 BCE, for example, contains a recipe for beer. Others, appearing later, 1700 to 1500 BCE, contain algorithms for an array of algebraic operations. As mathematician Donald Knuth described,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.